Good morning, children. We are going to start our second lesson of biology, class 6. The same chapter, chapter 3, cell. It's part 2, okay? Children, before we go into the next half, or we start with the next part, let us go through what we have studied earlier. Okay, let us do a recap. So what did we study in the last video lesson? We studied what do you mean by biology, isn't it? And I told you about two Greek terms, that is bios and logos. Remember, bios means life and logos means study. So together, what does biology mean? Study of living organisms. I also told you about the father of biology. Who was the father of biology? I told you Aristotle, isn't it? I hope you have memorized the spelling of Aristotle. Okay. Now we come to the next this one. What we studied, the definition of a cell, isn't it? What was the definition of a cell? The cell is the structural and functional unit of life. Who discovered the cell? It was Robert Hooke, and he saw it under a microscope which he himself prepared, and it was appearing as a honeycomb like structure, isn't it? I told you. Okay, now then comes the cell theory. I told you 3 points of cell theory. What were they? All living things are composed of cells, the first one. Second one, the cell is the structural and functional unit of living things. I told you why structural and why functional, isn't it? I also discussed the third point, that is all cells come from the division of the pre-existing cells, and for which a Latin sentence was given, which is omnis cellula e cellula. Okay, the next part we came through was who formulated the cell theory. Who were the scientists? They were M. Skeleton. The next one was Theodor Schwann, good, and Rudolf Virchow. These three scientists formulated the cell theory. The size and the shapes of different types of cells. We discussed, first of all, that always when we are observing a cell, they are measured in a unit called microns or micrometer. And how much one micron or micrometer is equal to? It is 0.001 millimeter, isn't it? Okay. We discussed the smallest cell in human body. It was RBC, that is the red blood cells. Then we discussed the largest cell, which was that? Remember, it was the bird's egg. Bird's egg means specially ostrich egg. It is the largest one. And the longest cell we discussed was nerve cell. Okay. Now, next I told you about white blood cells, isn't it? A very important characteristic of white blood cells, I told you that they have the capability of migrating from the bloodstream through the walls of the blood vessels and coming out into the surrounding space to kill the germs or bacteria which have entered into our body. That's so it is a very important quality of white blood cells. Okay, so I told you about fat cells which store the fat. I also told you about ciliated cells which are present in the lining of the nose and windpipe, isn't it? Now we also discussed about electron microscope, which has magnified the small microscopic things into bigger things. Nearly 1,000 times it has increased the size. Now, and this electron microscope was discovered by Noll and Ruska of Germany in 1932. I also told you about the difference between unicellular and multicellular organisms. Unicellular organisms are those organisms which have only one cell in their body. I gave you the example, that was amoeba. And multicellular organisms are those organisms which have more than one cell in their body, or numerous cells in their body. And examples can be given as plants, animals, whatever we see, living organisms we see around us. Okay. So I told you, I gave you some question answers, children. I didn't tell you the type of copy or text copy you will use. I am telling it. The copy will be a large size, big size, practical copy. That is, one side will be white and other side will be a ruled side. Okay. So practical copy you will buy. big one and write the question answers which I have given in the previous lesson. So let us start with the second part of this chapter. Okay. Now, structure of a cell. We'll deal with a cell. We studied how it was discovered, what was the cell theory, different types of cell. But what does a typical cell? Typical means a normal cell with all the minimum structures looks like, and what are the structures? We'll deal with that first. So you can see a diagram also alongside I have placed there. So you can match it and I'll also discuss along with it. So the typical cell consists of three parts. What are the three parts? The cell membrane. Now, which one is the cell membrane? So the diagram, the outer covering, okay? The outer lining of the cell is known as the cell membrane. See, it is marked on the left hand side, cell membrane, or which is also known as the plasma membrane. Cell membrane or plasma membrane, they are just synonymous terms, okay? Now, cell membrane, cytoplasm. Which part is the cytoplasm? That light beige color part you can see, that is light creamish color part all around just inside the cell membrane, that is the cytoplasm. And can you see the nucleus, the third part? Nucleus is the purple colored part, the light purple colored big part, not the small one inside. The big purple colored part in between the cell is the nucleus, which is also bounded by a membrane. We'll discuss that. Okay. So, first we'll deal with cell membrane. Now, children, cell membrane, as I told you, is the outer covering of each cell. That is, it is bounding the whole cell, okay, from the outside. It is living. Very important part, it is living. The cell membrane, which is bounding the whole cell, is a living part. It is very thin, it is delicate, and selectively permeable. Now, what do you mean by selectively permeable? I'll discuss in the function part again. Select means, I think all of selectively comes from the word select. What does select mean? To choose. Okay. So, permeable means what? What things can, is permitted to move in or move out. Permeable comes from the word permit. Permit means, for example, you take permission for going out of the class, isn't it? From the teacher. Similarly, this cell membrane is permeable, selectively permeable. Not everything can move in and move out. So let us discuss about this selectively permeable membrane. Okay, functions. Controls the entry and exit of materials. Any material which our body is taking, when it is absorbed by the cell, its entry or exit is controlled by the cell membrane. That is the meaning of semi-permeable membrane or selectively permeable. They are one and the same, semi-permeable or selectively permeable. It allows only selective substances to pass through it. It does not allow everything to pass through it. Okay. Next function. Provides protection to the internal contents of the cell. Naturally, if it is a bounding membrane, it will hold the internal contents as well as give protection to the internal contents of the cell. Okay. Now, let us now go to the next slide. Now, here you can see the first point which I have written, note. What note I have written? In plant cell, there is an additional cell wall outside the cell membrane. This cell wall is non-living, made up of complex carbohydrate called cellulose. Now, what does this mean? Remember, children, this we saw the cell membrane, okay? But cell membrane is the outer layer in animal cell. There are, if animals are there, they will be having a type of cell, and plants have a different type of cell. Now, in plant cell, apart from the cell membrane, one more outer layer is present, that is cell wall. That means cell wall will be the outer layer in plant cell, then will be coming the cell membrane. So cell membrane is inside the cell wall, and this is non-living. Remember, cell membrane was living. This is non-living. Cell wall is non-living. And it is made up of complex carbohydrate called cellulose. Complex carbohydrate, first of all, what is carbohydrate? Carbohydrate for you, it's simply, I'll explain. Many, you know about sugars, right? Glucose, fructose, all these are sugars. Glucose, all of you know, I suppose. Now, this glucose, when many molecules of glucose attach together, they form a carbohydrate called cellulose. Clear? So, it is a very complex carbohydrate. Now, we'll come to the next one, that is cytoplasm. Now, I told you that cream color or beige color part of the cell is known as the cytoplasm. You can see that inside the cell membrane, the cytoplasm is present. Now, it is jelly-like, okay? It is not very liquid like water. It contains a variety of small structures called the cell organelles. A very important part, cell organelles. Remember. Now, what you must be thinking, what does this cell organelle mean, isn't it? Now, children, you know your body contains many organs. Like, think of some of the organs. What are they? Lungs, heart, intestine, stomach. All these are present inside our body. So, these are our body organs. Okay? But inside a small microscopic cell, that cell also has many small organs. Okay? The cell also has many small organs. I have written some of the names like mitochondria, lysosome, ribosome. We'll deal with it later. But for the time being, what I am telling is, why then it is not written cell organs and written cell organelles? Because you know that cell is microscopic. And think, if cell is only microscopic, the organs of the cell will be much more smaller. So that's why the term organ is not given. A term organelle is given. Means very small organs are called organelles. Okay? That's why the word cell organelle. So, what all structures are present inside the cell are known as cell organelles. Apart from the cell organelles, what are also present? Inclusions. What does inclusion mean? Things which are included means inclusions. Okay? The things which are included are called the inclusions. And what are the inclusions? Storage products. You know what we store in our body? We store fats, we store proteins, etc. in our body. Clear? Now, it lies in between the cell membrane and nuclear membrane. Now, children, have a look on the diagram. See, I told you that the outer membrane is called the cell membrane. I told you about the nucleus. This light purple colored structure is called the nucleus. Now, this nucleus is also bounded by a membrane which is known as the nuclear membrane. So, this cytoplasm is present between this cell membrane and nuclear membrane. Okay. Now, come to the next point. All metabolic activities takes place in the cytoplasm. All metabolic activities means chemical reactions. Okay. Whatever chemical reactions taking place in our cell mainly takes place in the cytoplasm. Okay. Okay. Now we come to the nucleus. Prominent cell organelle. Which one is the prominent cell organelle they are telling? Nucleus. Nucleus is also a cell organelle present inside the cytoplasm. So, it is also a cell organelle. Spherical or oval in shape. It is called the brain of the cell. See, I have written in italics this one because it is very important. I have put it inside the inverted commas. Now, why it is called the brain of the cell? Questions are given. Okay? Listen very carefully. It is called the brain of the cell because it regulates the cell functions. All the functions of the cell are regulated by this nucleus. As for example, when we are performing any, when we have to work or do some work, our brain gives us the signal, okay, go and do this work. Similarly, what function or what work a cell has to perform, the nucleus gives the signal, okay, go and perform this work. That's why it is called the brain of the cell. Clear? Okay. Now, this nucleus is made up of two parts. What are the two parts? The nuclear membrane. As I told you, this nucleus is bounded by a membrane, a thin layer, which is known as the nuclear membrane, which is double layered. We'll come into the details of this in the next slide. First, nucleus is bounded by the nuclear membrane. And second one is the nucleoplasm. Now, nucleoplasm means what? As the cell was bounded, the cell as a whole was bounded by a cell membrane. Inside the cell membrane was a jelly-like thing or substance which was known as the cytoplasm. Similarly, inside the cytoplasm, there is one more structure called nucleus. And this cell organelle is bounded by the nuclear membrane. And inside this nuclear membrane binds. Or inside this nuclear membrane is present another fluid substance which is known as the nucleoplasm. Okay? And this nucleoplasm contains what organelles? The nucleolus. Can you see a big dark purple dot? That is the nucleolus. See the diagram? And chromosomes, or in bracket I have written chromatin material. Chromatin material are thread-like structures, okay, inside the nucleus. Not inside the nucleolus, inside the nucleus. Nucleolus and nucleus are two different terms. Nucleus is present inside the cell. And nucleolus is present inside the nucleus. Clear? Okay. It will be more clear when we go to the next slide. Now, let us go into the next slide. Okay. In this slide, you can see, children, that the first one is the nucleus only. We are explaining the parts, that is nuclear membrane and nucleoplasm, isn't it? Now, this nucleus consists of two main parts we discussed earlier, that is nuclear membrane and nucleoplasm. I have put the diagram alongside. So, children, when I am teaching you, go through the diagrams also along with that. Okay. Now, children, first, when I begin with this nuclear membrane, the first point which is written is surrounds the nucleus. I told you earlier that nuclear membrane surrounds the nucleus. Now, see this diagram alongside the nuclear membrane which I have, or the structure of the nucleus which is there on the right hand side of the writing part. Now, here you can see that the nucleus, only the nucleus is here, okay, children. It is not the full cell. So, be very specific, means I am telling it clearly. Here, only the nucleus is shown. Okay, now this outer brown colored part you can see is the nuclear membrane, and this is a double membrane. This part is not written in your book. I am telling you because it is a very important feature of nuclear membrane. Double membrane means two layers are there. Okay, it is not a single layer. Double layers of membrane are there. That's why it is known as double membrane. Okay, surrounds the nucleus. Which one? The nuclear membrane. Now, permeable in nature. Permeable means permits substances to move in and move out. Structure is same as plasma membrane. Okay, the structure of nuclear membrane is same as the plasma membrane. You have a diagram in the book also, children, in where we were discussing about the structure of the cell membrane and the cytoplasm. You can see that the cell membrane structure is also given. So you don't have to go into the details of that structure. Just it is same as the nuclear membrane and the plasma membrane have the same structure. Okay. Now, the third point is contain many pores called the nuclear pores. Now, see this diagram, children. You can see that in that brown layer, you can see some slits are given. Those slits are actually the nuclear pores. So, many pores are there. Through those pores only, the substances move in and move out. Clear? So, you can see in the diagram that I have marked the nuclear membrane. The nucleoplasm, that is the greenish, the sap green colored part is the nucleoplasm. It is the fluid part of the nucleus. You can see the nuclear pore. Okay, you can see the nuclear pore. You can also see the nucleolus, not nucleus, nucleolus. It is the this whitish and blackish colored part. And you can see one other thing which is known as chromatin. Now, I'll explain you the difference between chromosome and chromatin when I go into the next part of the this slide, that is nucleoplasm. Now, nucleoplasm is a colorless, dense fluid. Dense means the density is very high. It is not very fluid or very liquid substance. So, it is colorless. It does not have any color. It is dense fluid surrounded by a nuclear membrane. It is surrounded, which is surrounded by a nuclear membrane? The nucleoplasm. So, if you are asked a question that nucleoplasm is surrounded by which membrane? It will be nuclear membrane. If you are asked cytoplasm is surrounded by which membrane? It is cell membrane. Clear? Okay. Now, it contains nucleolus and chromatin material. Nucleolus, I told you, this dark colored, black colored, this one structure is known as the nucleolus. It is a solid ball. It is not surrounded by any membrane, this nucleolus. And it is a solid structure. And chromatin material. Okay. Now, in the previous slide, you saw, children, one place chromosome as well as chromatin material is written. Now, there is a difference between this chromatin and chromosome. Okay, that's why I have placed two diagrams in this slide. Now, see, children, in the first diagram, that is which is bounded by a brown colored membrane, see in there, you can see some thread-like structures, very thin. Can you see? Thread-like structures, they are actually called the chromatin. When the cell is not dividing, you know that cells divide? The cell, when we were very small, Now you can see your size as when you have seen your earlier photographs. You are very small. Your mother used to carry you in your in her arms, isn't it? Now you have become very big. You are in class 6. Now it is a little bit problematic for your mother to carry you in your arms. But why have you, or how have you grown this much big? Because the cells were continuously dividing, and this increased number of cells has resulted in the big structure of your body. Now, when the cell is not dividing, I am telling you, then this thread-like structures are seen in this cell, inside the cell. And this thread-like structures are known as chromatin. And see the diagram which is below, the purple-colored structure. Okay? In this structure, can you see? Not the nucleolus. See this structure written chromosomes, X-like structures, can you see? What happens when the cell starts dividing? Okay? The chromatin, which is thread-like, becomes condensed. Condensed means clumps and comes together to form these X-like structures. And these X-like structures are known as chromosomes. So, what is the difference between these chromosomes and chromatin? That is, when the cell is not dividing, the chromatin is seen. That is, thread-like structures are seen in the under the electron microscope. And when the cell starts dividing, always the cell is not dividing. When a signal is given by the nucleus, then only the cell starts to divide. When the cell starts dividing, then these chromatin become condensed and very in a cluster form forms these X-like structures, which are known as the chromosomes. So hope I think this chromatin and chromosomes part is clear to you all. Okay. Though questions will not be asked, then also it should be clear in your mind. The concept should be clear. Okay. So, it contains the nucleolus and chromatin material. Which one is the nucleolus? The spherical body not bounded by any membrane. See this nucleolus, that black color diagram or structure which you can see inside these sap green colored nucleoplasm. This is the nucleolus. It is not bounded by any membrane. It is rich in a protein. It is rich in protein. Protein is present in here lot. And one chemical which is known as RNA. The full form also I have written here. Ribonucleic acid. Okay. RNA full form is asked in the examination. So, be very particular with learning this full form. Along with the spelling. If the spelling is wrong, your marks will be cut. Okay, what is the function of this nucleolus? It produces ribosomes. Ribosome is a cell organelle which we will deal with in the coming videos. Okay, the next part of which comes under this nucleoplasm is the chromatin material. Network of thread-like intertwined mass. Intertwined means it is coiled mass. Okay, it is coiled among itself. All these thread-like structures. That's why intertwined, coiled around each other. Composed of genetic substance called DNA. Chromatin materials contains a chemical or substance which is known as DNA. DNA full form also I have written deoxyribonucleic acid. Full form very important from the examination point of view. Also RNA and proteins. Now in this sentence you have come across a word which is known as genetic. It will be more clear. Anything which is concerned with genes is known as genetic. Now, when we come to the next part, you will understand what you mean by genetic. Okay. In a dividing cell, the DNA is highly condensed into chromosomes. I told you earlier, this diagram which is at the bottom of the slide. The chromatin has become condensed because it is a dividing cell and it has formed chromosomes. The chromatin material has formed chromosomes. The chromosomes contain basic hereditary units called genes. These chromosomes contain hereditary units. What do you mean by hereditary? Anything which we get from our parents is the meaning of heredity. Okay? Anything. That is transmission of characters from parents to offsprings. Or offsprings means what? Children. Is known as heredity. And these genes come from parents to the children. That's why they are hereditary structures or units. Genes are responsible for transmission of characters from parents to offspring. For example, I'm giving you an example. See, if you, for example, your father has straight hair, okay, and your mother has curly hair. The child sees, oh, I have curly hair. That means whose genes are shown in your hair type? The mother's genes. Why? Because your mother was having curly hair. And so you are having curly hair. Clear? So genes are those structures inside the nucleus, or actually inside these chromosomes. In the chromosomes, these genes are present. Small structures which are known as the genes. And what these genes do? They are responsible for transmission of characters. The characters from your parents to yourself is done by these genes. Clear? Fill in the blanks come from this part, children. That what are genes or dash are responsible for transmission of hereditary characters from parents to offspring. So the answer will be genes. And if you are asked what are the basic hereditary units, so you will write genes. Which part or contains the basic hereditary units called genes? The chromosomes. Okay. Let us go into the next slide. We come to the cell wall. We discussed about the cell wall earlier in a very short way. Now, we'll talk about cell wall. Now, what do you mean by this cell wall? I told you earlier that cell wall is present in which type of cell? It is plant cell and not animal cell. Okay, apart from plant cell, many are there. But if very specifically we tell, in plant cell, this cell wall is present outside the cell membrane. So, plant cells have a cell wall surrounding the cell membrane. Cell wall is made up of cellulose, a non-living substance. Remember, very important point. If you are asked the difference between cell wall and cell membrane, one very important point you can write that cell wall is non-living and cell membrane is a living structure. Okay? Okay, next point. Fully permeable, that is, it allows substance to in a solution form to enter and leave the cell. Fully permeable, okay, it is a very good security guard. It does not allow, or it always tells, okay, go in, go out. He will not tell, okay, don't go, nothing like that he tells. That is the cell wall. Everything can go out, everything can come in, okay. So, imagine cell wall is a very lenient security guard, and cell membrane is a very tough one. It doesn't allow everything to come in and come out. Okay. It is also a very important point of difference between cell wall and cell membrane. See, cell wall is fully permeable, allows everything to move in and move out. But cell membrane is not fully permeable. It is selectively permeable. Means it selects what to go in and come out. Okay. Cellulose. What do you mean by this cellulose with which this cell wall is made up of? I told you it is a structural carbohydrate. Structural means it forms the structure. That's why structural. Carbohydrate, why? Because I told you it is made up of many molecules of glucose, that is sugar. And is considered as a complex sugar. It is considered which one? The cellulose is considered as a complex sugar. Cell wall is a characteristic feature in plants. Characteristic feature in plants as well as bacteria, fungi and algae. Okay. Now, algae, I think most of you have seen, but you don't know. Have you seen that on the surface of the pond, a green colored scum is there? Those are actually algae. Okay. Fungi also most of you have seen. Fungi, I'm telling you, have you seen in the rainy season, your mother's leather bags, if she has small vanity bags or any leather bags you have in your home, there is a light deposition of a grayish colored something. Layer comes on the surface of these leather bags, that is actually a fungi. Okay, you have also seen that when you keep these bread very long inside the somewhere in the kitchen, it's kept, you will see a bluish greenish blue colored structure comes on the surface. Those are all fungi. Okay, they are called bread mold. Okay, so all these have cell wall. But cell wall of bacteria and fungi have different composition. In the next slide, you will see the structure of bacteria I have put there. So, for the time being, let us go into the functions of cell wall. Okay. So, bacteria and fungi have a different type of cell wall. And these plant cells have a different type of cell wall. This you will learn in the higher classes. What type of composition is there. Okay. Now, coming to the functions. The first one is provides shape to the plant. Naturally, it is very rigid in structure. It is very tough. So, that's why it gives a shape to the plant's cell. It gives the plant a proper shape. Storage of carbohydrate. It helps in the storage of carbohydrate, that is sugars. Provides rigidity. Rigidity means firmness. Okay, firmness to the plant cell. Tensile strength means doesn't let the plant cell break very easily. It doesn't let. So, tensile strength is provided. And structural support. It gives a form or structure to the plant cell. Protection against mechanical stress. For example, too much of harsh wind is blowing. So, if it is very hard, then the plant will break. But in light wind, this plant doesn't break apart. Okay? Because the stress, mechanical stress means what? Pressure. Any pressure, it can withstand. And also infection. It doesn't let the bacteria and other germs to enter the plant cell. Resist water pressure. For example, you know that from the soil, the roots are absorbing water continuously. Okay, in the rainy season, you know the soil has lots and lots of amount of water. Now, if the roots are continuously absorbing water, that means the plant cell is becoming fully saturated with water. Now, what will happen? It might happen that the cell bursts. But due to the presence of this cell wall, it doesn't let the cell to burst and it remains intact. And it also helps in cell growth. The growth of the cell is enhanced with the help of this cell wall. Let us go into the next slide. Prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. These are two different types of cells. Okay. Two different types of cells which we can see and we'll learn about them now. Prokaryotic and eukaryotic. Now, children, pro means this prokaryotic. First, we'll deal with prokaryotic. Pro means what? Early. Very early ancient time. And karyotic. Karyotic word comes from this term carry on. Carry on means nucleus. So, a very ancient type of old type of nucleus is present. And what is the nucleus all about and what is the thing? We'll see in this slide. Plasma membrane. It has a plasma membrane but lacks certain cell organelles. Some organelles are present, such as certain cell structures are present, but not all. Ribosomes and few plasmids and all will come in. DNA and all these things are present, but not all structures are present. So it has a plasma membrane, but lacks certain cell organelles. Very important point. The nucleus is not well developed. Again, very, very important. Nucleus is not well developed and is without a nuclear membrane. See the diagram alongside, a bacterial diagram. This is the diagram of a bacteria. Just alongside the prokaryotic cell. See, you can see that no bounding nuclear membrane is there. The coil structure which you can see is the chromatin, okay, which we discussed, okay. And it is not bounded by any membrane. So, the nuclear membrane is not present in this prokaryotic cell. And this nucleus, which is not bounded by a nuclear membrane, this structure is known as the nucleoid. That is, this full coil structure which you can see is known as the nucleoid. So, what do you mean by a nucleoid? The nucleus which is not well developed and is without a nuclear membrane is known as a nucleoid. Means, in case of our cell, okay, that is, we are eukaryotes, we'll come to that. In our cell, the structure inside the big structure inside the cytoplasm, that is, it is called the nucleus, okay. But in their case, in case of prokaryotes, it is not called the nucleus, it is called the nucleoid. Why nucleoid? Because it is not bounded by a nuclear membrane. Example is given, it is bacterium. Okay, so you can see the diagram alongside what I told. It is bounded by a plasma membrane. It is there. Plasma membrane is also there. The cell wall is also there outside this plasma membrane. And inside this cytoplasm, which you can see in light blue colored, what is there? The nucleoid is present. Why it is called nucleoid and not nucleus? Because it is not bounded by any membrane. Let us come to the eukaryotic cells. This eukaryotic cell or eukaryote can be broken into two terms. U means true. E-U means true. And karyotic comes from the word karyon, means nucleus, means they have a true nucleus. Now, what does this true nucleus means? Has a bounding plasma membrane. Has a bounding plasma membrane. Plasma membrane is there. And various membrane bound cell organelles are present. Most of the cell organelles are present. And these cell organelles, each cell organelle, that is organs of the cell, is bounded by a membrane of its own. Okay. Now, Nucleus is well developed with a nuclear membrane. Okay, the nucleus is well developed. I have shown a diagram of a paramecium here, which is given in your books also. So, the nucleus is well developed with a nuclear membrane. Okay. So, these are the prokaryotic and eukaryotic. Now, the difference between prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell is given in your book. Apart from that, if question comes, what you can write? The prokaryotic cells lack certain cell organelles. But in case of eukaryotic cells, most of the cell organelles are present, which are membrane bound. First point. Second point, what you can write? The nucleus is not well developed in case of prokaryotic cell and is without a nuclear membrane. Hence, it is called a nucleoid. In case of eukaryotic cell, nucleus is well developed with nuclear membrane. Examples are also given, but examples do not form a point of difference, children. Please remember, you write the examples and you think you will get marks. That is not the case. You have to write one point and then you can give the examples, that is agreed. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. Now, some interesting facts. Okay, what are the interesting facts? See, bacteria and chlamydomonas. Chlamydomonas is given in your book. The diagram is very nicely given in your book. The bacteria and chlamydomonas are unicellular plants. Okay, while amoeba and paramecium are unicellular animals. So, if you are asked, name one unicellular animals, you cannot write chlamydomonas there because it is a plant. You have to write amoeba or paramecium. In case of unicellular plants, bacteria and chlamydomonas are applicable. Smallest cells are Mycoplasma gallisepticum. Now, this Mycoplasma is a type of bacteria, though it is smaller than bacteria also. Remember this name, it is asked a lot of times. Smallest cells are Mycoplasma, M-Y-C-O, Myco, P-L-A-S-M-A, Plasma. Gallisepticum, Galli, G-A-L-L-I, Galli, Sep, S-E-P, Sep, T-I-T-C-U-M, Cum, Gallisepticum. Okay, now next point is all eukaryotic cells contain a nucleus except red blood cell. Remember, in mammals, what do you mean by mammals? I think all of you know about mammals. Any organism which feeds its young ones or children with milk, or it is milk produced by the mammary glands, okay, are known as the mammals. Now, all eukaryotic cells, what I told you the meaning, which have a true nucleus, okay. Now, these true nucleus is bounded by a nuclear membrane, and all these eukaryotic cells have a nucleus, a true nucleus inside them, except, exception is red blood cells in case of mammals. They do not, the mature RBCs do not have a nucleus. Remember, mature RBCs, I am telling mature, not immature. Immature RBCs, when they are very just, they have been formed, they have a nucleus, but later on that nucleus is pinched off, is removed. So, mature RBCs do not have a nucleus. You will learn the reason why in higher classes. And phloem sieve tubes, you have the red cells, red blood cells diagram in your book, but phloem sieve tubes diagram is not given. So, I have shown the diagram here in this slide. These phloem sieve tubes in plants, they are present, not in animals. Okay. Now, you know about xylem and phloem. Xylem conducts water from the soil. And what does this phloem do? This phloem, which is written here, it conducts prepared food. You know that leaves prepare the food for the plant. And this food is taken from the leaves to different parts of the plant by this phloem. P-H-L-O-E-M. Phloem. Okay. And which part of the phloem? The sieve tubes of the phloem. These cells, they do not have the nucleus. Can you see this dark sap green colored part? See, no nucleus is there. But just alongside companion cell in the diagram, you can see they have a nucleus. But these cells do not have a nucleus. So, phloem sieve tubes in the plants do not have a nucleus. This is all for today's lesson. We have dealt with a lot of things today in this session. Now, children, you will go through all these parts, okay? What we have learned and all these things. And you also saw that when I wrote about these interesting facts when we are dealing with, I wrote some of the points in italics. Have you seen? So, actually, they are all scientific names. That's why I have written those names in italics. Now, I'll tell an interesting fact about these scientific names in the coming session, in the new new class video lesson, next video lesson, which I'll upload. And please stay tuned and go through all these things which I have told. Listen to the videos clearly, sit with the books and practice all the diagrams which are given there. Okay, do not waste your time because this time is very precious. And you are sitting at home, don't waste your time just playing in the mobile or watching TV. Utilize your time. Okay, children? I'll be back with a new, another video lesson very soon. So, bye-bye for now. Thank you.